Well, hello again, everyone, and thank you so much for joining this webinar. I'm really excited to be part of this panel here today to tell the story of what we're calling Biketoria and how the city of Victoria aims to be one of the best small cities in the world for cycling. For those of you who might be from further afield, a little bit of context on Victoria. It's a relatively small community on the southern tip of Vancouver Island in British Columbia. It's a livable, prosperous, and vibrant city. And unlike many areas of Canada, it actually has a mild climate year-round, gets very little snowfall, and it also has gentle topography, and it's a very compact city with a compact urban area. And because of this, and a number of the attributes of the community, the topography, the weather, the compactness, it really is an ideal city for cycling. And over the past several decades, the city has been making some improvements for cycling. And currently the city has one of the highest cycling commute mode shares among major cities in North America, with about 11% of commute trips made to work. But what I would argue is that this mode share has been achieved despite the city's infrastructure and not necessarily as a result of the city's infrastructure. So as a part of this project in terms of the Biketoria, we're looking at how the city can move from being a city that has good conditions for cycling but not really great infrastructure, and by putting in great infrastructure, it's looking to become a world leading city and one of the best small cities for cycling. So we'll tell a little bit of that story. As I mentioned, I was fortunate to be part of the consulting team. I was the consulting lead for our firm, Urban Systems, who worked on this project, along with, and I want to thank my colleagues and partners who worked on this, including Kate Bernias, who led this locally from our Victoria office, and also want to thank all of our partners who worked on this project, Alta Planning and Design, Gale Architects, and 8 to 80 Cities. We worked all as a team to develop the plan as well as the designs for the corridor. As well as working with City of Victoria staff, council, and a really, really engaged group of citizens that helped really pull this project together. So as Darren mentioned, the webinar will first provide an overview of the Biketoria project. So I'll start with this presentation, and then we'll open it up to panel discussion and some questions and answers to bring together various perspectives on perhaps the issues, challenges, and possibilities that Victoria is facing from a variety of perspectives, whether it be a political perspective, an advocacy perspective, or a business perspective. And that's why we selected these panelists to be part of this discussion, to share their stories and their perspectives, and hopefully to use those lessons from their perspectives to inspire other communities and learn from Victoria and share some of the issues and challenges we've learned through this process. And hopefully you can share that and apply some of these lessons to your communities. So the Biketoria project, to get started, as I mentioned, the City of Victoria is already a good city for cycling. It's been recognized as Canada's cycling capital. It's been tagged with that nickname in some cases. And the city has always been supportive of cycling. The city has been investing modestly over the past 20 years in cycling infrastructure, but not really all ages and abilities cycling infrastructure. But what's different about this project is something that came directly from political will from Mayor Lisa Helps and the other members of council. Council has made an unprecedented commitment to building an active transportation network that is safe and comfortable for people of all ages and abilities, and that connects all neighborhoods and destinations within the city. So council has made this commitment, and they've supported that with the largest investment in cycling infrastructure in the city's history. So through this commitment, the city's allocated $7.7 million for cycling infrastructure to build this network of all ages and abilities facilities by 2018. So that's an important part of the story. It took political will, there's allocated funding, and it's intended to be rapid implementation. And as you can see from the quote here from Mayor Lisa Helps, the intent is to build this network over the next 3 years by 2018 within this first, within their term on council here. So really the Biketoria came from very strong and bold leadership by city council, who want to rapidly build this network within their term on council, and really to transform the city and to transform how people travel through Victoria, whether it's by cycling or other modes of transportation through the city. Whoops. One slide too many. So despite its name, Biketoria, I do want to emphasize this project was about much more than cycling. And recognizing that cycling is not an end in and of itself. itself. It's really a means to broader ends, and it's really intended to help help the community in the City of Victoria achieve its broader goals related to health, equity and affordability, economic development, the environment, and overall trying to create a livable and vibrant community. The city also recognizes the really important economic and business benefits that come along with investing in and implementing a high-quality all-ages and abilities cycling network. The city is really actively trying to support thriving local businesses and to create a city that is attractive to businesses, to attract and retain new businesses, recognizing it's in a competitive global economy. Through that, it's looking to invest in and support emerging technologies, the tech sector, tourism, and other aspects of attracting businesses, and then attracting their employees to the Victoria City and the surrounding region, and recognizing that with kind of new and emerging businesses and millennial population, just how important having good transportation choices is very important to this project. The city is also very interested in supporting local businesses and how we can encourage people to shop locally through provision of high-quality transportation facilities. So this slide was referencing, in addition to the kind of overall community benefits and economic benefits, also looking at, and perhaps most critically for this project, creating a transportation system that is comfortable and safe and attractive for people of all ages and abilities, whether it's 8-year-olds to 80-year-olds and everything in between, and really is designed to create a network that everybody in the city can use, and looking at cycling, but also looking at opportunities for walking, for placemaking and urban design, and for other features here, and recognizing that by doing so, that will help achieve the city's aspirations for health, environment, safety, and to create an equitable transportation system. And this really builds on, for those of you who may have seen Ryan Martinson's recent webinar on Calgary's City Centre Cycle Track Network pilot project. I think a lot of the themes in this webinar are very similar to what Calgary was doing with their City Centre Cycle Track Network, and a lot of the lessons that Ryan shared I think are applicable here as well. So as I mentioned, City Council made a bold commitment with this project to develop a world-leading cycling network, and really to be a world-class cycling city. And to help achieve that, we worked with our partners at Alta Planning and 880 Cities and Gale Architects to bring in some of the world experts in bicycle infrastructure planning and design to make sure we could come up with recommendations, a network plan, and designs that really are world-class and represent the experiences that our team has, ranging from Copenhagen to Bogota and a number of other cities around the world. So I want to thank all of our team members here for their participation in the study. So based on what I've said so far, recognizing Victoria has the highest commute mode share for cycling in Canada, it's got a lot of attributes that are really attractive to cycling, there's strong political will and support, and even the media has been relatively supportive, some editorials in the newspapers locally talking about the need to develop Victoria. Shows everything's good, right? Everything's supportive. What could possibly go wrong? Well, like most cities, most communities around North America and elsewhere, cycling can be a polarizing, contentious, hot-button issue. And there certainly were a number of different perspectives throughout the Biketoria process, and whether it's related to issues and concerns associated with loss of parking and the perceived economic impacts of that, concerns about congestion and traffic impacts, concerns about business impacts, and concerns from some residents and stakeholders and businesses about this project moving too fast and about perhaps a lack of consultation. So a lot of opinions came forth through this process, and we want to highlight some of those challenges and how they influenced our process through this presentation and discussion as well, because I think a lot of these concerns that we experienced here in Victoria are common to many other cities who might be looking to provide cycling infrastructure. So a little bit more about Victoria specifically. So here's a map of North America, and as I mentioned, Victoria is on the southern tip of Vancouver Island, actually below the 49th parallel. Victoria itself is a relatively small city within a larger urban region. The regional government is called the Capital Regional District, and they're responsible for planning and land use decisions within the broader region, which includes 13 municipalities. So Biketoria is at the center of this region, which includes many, many different jurisdictions with each of these regional governments. And then within Biketoria itself, Biketoria is a relatively small community. It's about 20 square kilometers and has about 80,000 residents. It's a small community, but it's also a diverse community. And this map here is showing the unique and distinct neighborhoods throughout the city. So there's about a dozen really distinct neighborhoods, and that was an important part of designing the Biketoria network, was ensuring that the network connects all neighborhoods and destinations within the city. Biketoria itself, it's a waterfront city with a lot of storied history, particularly the fact it's founded on British roots. So you see a lot of, you know, beautiful architecture with the Empress Hotel. It's our provincial capital as well, the seat of the provincial government here in British Columbia. And in recent years, the city has been focusing on kind of, as I mentioned, encouraging new tech industries, but also tourism within the city. It's now, as an example, one of the busiest cruise ship ports in Canada for tourists coming to the city. Historically, the city of Biketoria has been a city that's had a significant seniors and older adult population. Because of this history, but in recent years there's been an influx of a younger generation, maybe due to affordability and lifestyle benefits in Biketoria, and has been attracting an increasingly young demographic, and has earned the catchphrase that it's for the newlywed and nearly dead, and that's kind of the demographics that Biketoria had seen. But in recent years, that's changing even further, and Biketoria is really becoming an emerging hip and cool city, as you can see from the headline here, and the city's trying to capitalize on this through its economic development strategy and with initiatives to attract the tech sector, to encourage entrepreneurial tourism and entrepreneurship and social enterprise, and looking at how providing a multimodal and accessible transportation system can really help to encourage those businesses and help them thrive and attract and retain employees. So some quick facts about Biketoria here. As I mentioned, it's a small community, 20 square kilometers, about 80,000 residents. And on the left, you see the mode share. So it's about an 11% mode share of commute trips to work based on our national census data. But when we look at all trips, it's much lower. This is based on the Capital Regional District's Household Trip Diary Survey, and shows that cycling is about 4% of all types of trips, not just commuting trips, but including trips to school and recreational and shopping trips, for example. When we look at 11%, that really places Biketoria on the leading edge of North American cities, as you can see through some examples on this graph here, with a mode share of 11% of commute trips made by bicycle, about double Portland's mode share, higher than Vancouver's and Seattle's and a number of other leading North American cities based on census data. So it's already doing very well in the North American context, but the city wants to push further and become push itself into the category of some of the world-leading cycling cities, whether that be Copenhagen, Amsterdam, or a number of other European cities where we see mode shares approaching 20, 30, or even above 40% in some cases with world-leading cities. So to give you an example of what the cycling infrastructure is currently like in Biketoria, one of the great assets that the Biketoria region has is a world-class pathway network that really functions both recreationally and for commuter purposes. A couple of the pathways are called the Galloping Goose Regional Trail and the Lochside Regional Trail, and they provide really great all ages and abilities facilities that act as a spine that funnel into the city of Biketoria. But within the city of Biketoria itself, the conditions in many cases are not really comfortable or safe for people of all ages and abilities, as you can see from this case here, in a case where there is a dedicated bicycle lane, but certainly not a safe or comfortable place for people to be cycling. And there are there's an extensive network of painted bike lanes throughout the city, but there's also many streets that don't have any cycling infrastructure and, again, aren't comfortable for people of all ages and abilities. So we're trying to take these streets and how can we adapt them, transform them to be more comfortable places. And again, this builds very much on Ryan Martinson's presentation of a couple of weeks ago. I think he titled it from hair-raising to family-friendly, and we're looking at the same context here in many cases in the city of Biketoria. So in terms of the process, we went through just a little bit of background on the study overview. The city had developed an initial network in 2014. So through this project, one of our first tasks was to recommend enhancements to that 2014 network to develop a long-term bicycle network, but also to develop between 4 and 8 priority corridors for implementation by 2018. And these would be all ages and abilities cycling corridors. For each of these priority corridors that we identified, we also developed detailed conceptual designs or conceptual plans along with cost estimates. We went through this process over 3 different phases over the course of the past several months. The first phase was a project launching phase where we were gathering background information and data and familiarizing ourselves with the context. Phase 2 was focused on network planning. So this was really looking at what is the long-term network and then what should these priority corridors be for rapid implementation by 2018. And then the third phase was focused on conceptual design as along with public engagement. So taking those 8 priority corridors, what sort of tools and treatments should we be looking at? What types of facilities would be appropriate on each of those 8 corridors? And using that information to come up with conceptual plans for each of those 8 corridors. Along the way, we had extensive engagement. I'll talk about that a little bit more in the presentation about what we did at various steps in the process. But the engagement really helped to inform both the network as well as the conceptual designs. And I think this is really interesting for Biketoria as well, because often when we're doing a long-term or citywide bicycle plan, you end up drawing lines on a map, but don't necessarily know what the implications of that are and the impacts. So by taking those lines on a map and actually developing concepts, it gave the city and stakeholders a very clear idea of what exactly we could fit within each of these streets and what the impacts and trade-offs might be. So I'll go over a little bit on the public engagement process that we went through throughout the course of the study. We had an extensive engagement process that helped inform the design of the network as well as the design of the corridors. A number of activities, the first activities we did were a big public launch where we brought in Mayor Lisa Helps as well as a couple of speakers on our team, Mia Burke from Alta Planning and Gil Penulosa from 880 Cities, to provide information about best practices from other cities and how those might apply to the planning and design of the Biketoria network. And we had a number of engagement labs along with that Biketoria summit, that public lecture. And we designed those engagement labs to really go out to where members of the community were. So we had an engagement lab. One was at the city's central library, and another was outside on one of the busiest street corners in the city. We were really explicitly trying to reach out to not just cyclists, people who are already using the system, but we really wanted to hear through our engagement process from people who aren't necessarily using it and maybe don't know about the Biketoria project, and tap into that and make sure we get their input from people who might use this network in the future. So that was a really important part of the design of our engagement program. And along with this first round of engagement, we also had a survey, and we heard from over 1,700 residents about what they would like to see from the Biketoria project. So we then moved in. The next phase of engagement was what we called a series of neighborhood salons. And at this point, whereas the first round was focused on network planning, the neighborhood salons were focused on identifying potential treatments for each of the priority corridors that we had identified. And we held these salons in, you know, coffee shops and other venues in different neighborhoods throughout the city, as you can see here in a local coffee shop here on one of the corridors. In an attempt to kind of not have a traditional open house style event, but make it a little bit more welcoming and informal, and having staff there to review some concepts and, of course, provide input on some of the early concepts we were thinking. And then we had an additional round of engagement, and this wasn't something that was originally part of the process, and really started from some of the issues and concerns I mentioned earlier on from some neighborhoods and businesses throughout the city who felt the project was moving perhaps too fast and that we weren't engaging adequately, and resulted in some backlash and some pushback, and resulted in some petitions from businesses and from neighborhood associations, and a really strong desire to have more engagement, have more conversation, so people could understand what we were proposing and have a conversation and tell us what the impacts would be. So we went back, we redesigned our process based on that lesson learned, that we needed to take more time and make sure we heard from all residents and businesses, and had more targeted engagement with a number of different neighborhood and business associations throughout the city to provide information, make sure that everybody had the same information and the facts in front of them, and then have targeted discussions about what the specifics impacts would be within each of those neighborhoods and along some of the business corridors, and how we might mitigate those impacts. We also had a technical advisory committee, which worked with us throughout the course of the project, representing a range of different perspectives, and that was very important, not just hearing from the cycling community on this committee, but we had the business community, placemaking and urban design, health, safety, students, accessibility community, and others represented on this committee. So that was very important to provide guidance to us throughout the process. And some of the things we heard throughout the process, specifically through the survey where I mentioned we had 1,700 responses, we just asked people, what are you most excited about when it comes to Biketoria? And we heard very clearly people want they want to feel safe when they're cycling. And that's a real opportunity through this network to have a safe place for them to cycle. They're excited about having more opportunities to cycle, being able to cycle with their kids and children, and being able to cycle downtown, an area that's not very bicycle friendly today. But of course, people had a number of concerns, as I mentioned, whether that would be impacts or perceived impacts on traffic and congestion, on parking, on the safety in terms of car and bike conflicts, on the cost of the project, and a number of other impacts that we wanted to identify and mitigate throughout the process. We asked people, just some examples of the questions we asked in the survey, whether the network connects to the places you want to go, and we heard overwhelmingly from about 3/4 of the population that the proposed network does connect with people where they want to go. We asked how often people currently bike, and the graph on the bottom left there, the pie chart, shows that we heard from a lot of regular cyclists. Kind of the pink and the blue show that about 58% of our respondents are regular cyclists who cycle every day or a few times a week. So that's great. We heard from people who are already using it, but as I mentioned, we really wanted to hear from people who aren't currently cycling so we could understand what could we do to get them to cycle, and would this network be attractive to them. And we heard from about 22% of people who either never cycle or occasionally cycle, which was pretty good, but admittedly we would have liked to see a higher number because we really were trying to reach out to that group, and I think that's a lesson learned. It's very hard to reach out and engage with people who aren't current users of the network. But we did hear from about 1/4 of people who aren't currently cycling, and another 1/4 who cycle occasionally. But definitely the majority of the respondents already are regular cyclists. But we did hear that people were more likely to cycle more once this new network is built. About 70% of respondents agreed or strongly agreed that when the network is built, they will cycle more. So that's great. And especially when we're looking at maybe the occasional or rare cyclists, a number of them said, yeah, when this is built, this, and if it is attractive and comfortable for people of all ages and abilities, they are more likely to use that. So in terms of how we actually designed the network and what the network looks like, this is a map of the city's bicycle network. So as I mentioned, the city has been investing over the past 20 years in a bicycle network, and they've created a network of nearly 50 kilometers of infrastructure, including the Galloping Goose Trail and multi-use pathways in green, a number of painted bike lanes and buffered bike lanes, and signed bicycle routes. But there's some issues with the current network. There's not a lot of facilities downtown, the areas where it's probably most needed. As you can see from the map, it's a very disconnected network. There's a lot of gaps in the network. And also, there aren't a lot of all ages and abilities facilities here. And when we look at what we would consider all ages and abilities in terms of multi-use pathways or physically separated facilities, there's almost nothing in the city of Victoria currently that would be considered all ages and abilities. So a lot of room for improvement in terms of the existing infrastructure here. The city also has a bicycle master plan, which was developed back in 1995, and this bicycle master plan lays the blueprint, or has laid the blueprint for the city on how it's been selecting which bicycle routes to implement over the past 20 years. And it's been a useful document. Many of the routes have been implemented, but what is particularly interesting about this bicycle master plan, which is over 20 years old, is that it explicitly says no routes downtown, and there is a big square around downtown with no lines identified. Which is very interesting in the area where you have the highest demand and perhaps the most hostile or unfriendly areas to cycle. The plan didn't identify anything within those areas. So moving forward from the Bicycle Master Plan, the city has now adopted its new strategic plan. And the strategic plan states that the city will be a national leader in cycling infrastructure by building an all ages and abilities cycling network by 2018. So that was the launching point for our process. Our process went through some technical analysis, some public engagement, building on the existing policy documents, and looking at the expertise that was on our team to come up, and the stakeholder engagement to come up with an enhanced bicycle network. And kind of inversely to the philosophy from the 1995 Bicycle Master Plan, which said no routes downtown, our approach really took the opposite approach. We did a number of analyses of the network that looked at where's the highest potential, where's the highest demand for cycling infrastructure, and found that really, not surprisingly, downtown, the heart of the city and the heart of the region with the most employment, is really, that's the area where we need to focus the most. So we developed the network based on this framework here, a hub and spoke approach, where it was focused on building a dense network of high quality facilities within the downtown core in blue there, and having spokes or spines that would connect in from various neighborhoods throughout the city, with, as you can see in the red arrows here. So we can provide those connections from all neighborhoods and destinations within the city. And then kind of filling those, that hub and spoke out with a grid of supporting bikeways, the green lines here, that would provide an enhanced network, more community routes that would provide connectivity throughout the city. And so when we're considering all ages and abilities, there's really three types of facilities we were considering. That includes protected bike lanes on busy streets, neighborhood greenways on quiet streets, and neighborhood greenways would be on local residential streets where bicycle traffic is prioritized through traffic diversion, traffic calming measures, but making it a really attractive place for cycling and for walking. And then off-street pathways as the third category, facilities that are physically separated from vehicle traffic, and building on and connecting with the Galloping Goose was really important there, and tying into the existing really wonderful off-street pathway network that's already in place in the region. So everything we did was really looking at what could we do looking at this toolkit of three facilities here. We established a number of guiding principles for the project. The first being, it needs to be comfortable. The network needs to be safe and comfortable for people of all ages and abilities. So that led and guided everything we did, along with creating a minimum grid network that ensures all residents have access to an all ages and abilities cycling facility within a short cycling distance. This is really important. If we really want to change how people travel throughout the city, it's not enough just to build one corridor or a couple of corridors. You need to provide a network, and a network of all ages and abilities facilities, and that's what will help the city really move forward and to achieve its aspirations to become a world-class city. And then thirdly, making sure that it's a convenient network and connects to all major destinations in the city. So looking at what are those destinations, if they're businesses, community amenities, schools, and neighborhoods throughout the city. So those were the three important guiding principles that we looked at to plan the network. But we also had two additional principles, recognizing that the city wants to build this priority network by 2018. So we wanted to prioritize corridors in areas where there was the highest demand. And then we also wanted to ensure they were doable. So we looked at feasibility of construction and what we could do cost effectively within the curb-to-curb width. We did a number of technical analyses, building on those guiding principles in terms of safety analyses, potential demand analyses. We did some network analyses, and this all helped inform the network along with our public engagement. And based on that, we identified a proposed long-term network, which included both what we call the primary network in purple, which would be kind of the long-term all ages and abilities network, and supported by the lines in blue, which would be a secondary network, which may or may not be all ages and abilities facilities, but more kind of supporting routes. So this long-term network would really cover all destinations and neighborhoods within the city. And then we took that to identify what would this priority network look like by 2018. And we identified 8 priority corridors, 4 north-south corridors and 4 east-west corridors for implementation. And these corridors, again, were intended to connect all destinations and neighborhoods throughout the city and represent about 25 kilometers of new all ages and abilities infrastructure throughout the city. And again, to put that in context with the size of Biketoria, 25 kilometers in a city that's only 20 square kilometers actually provides very, very good coverage once these 8 corridors are implemented. And in particular, we looked at how close residents would be to this AAA 2018 cycling network, and it would essentially place within 400 meters, almost all schools within the city would be within 400 meters of the network, most parks, almost all commercial centers, about 3/4 of the land area in the city would be within 400 meters of the bicycle network, so it does provide very good coverage throughout the city. So these are some examples of what our 8 corridors look like. The conditions on each street were, of course, very different. Some busy arterial streets, some quiet residential streets with traffic calming, and some streets that might be considered for pedestrian priority or maybe even pedestrianization in the future. And the facilities we looked at were cycle tracks and neighborhood bikeways. I mentioned earlier off-street pathways would be part of the toolkit, but since we were looking at rapid implementation and what's doable by 2018, we were really looking at on-street facilities within the curb. So some corridors have two-way cycle tracks on one side of the street on one-way streets. We have some one-way cycle tracks on busier streets, and then neighborhood bikeways with traffic calming and traffic diversion on quieter streets. And that's what the entire network consists of. So we also wanted to consider, as we were designing the network and especially going through our engagement with residents and businesses and other stakeholders, what are the impacts of this network on all road users, and what are the mitigation measures? And looking at it specifically from the transportation hierarchy that the city has established in their official community plan, which places vulnerable road users, pedestrians, and cyclists at the top of the hierarchy, followed by transit, commercial vehicles, and single occupancy vehicles. So we looked at what are the impacts and mitigation measures for all road users. Of course, for cycling, we were trying to create a safe and comfortable network to begin with, so we that was the whole objective of the plan. But it wasn't just about cycling. When it came to walking, we were looking at how cycling can help create a more comfortable walking environment. For example, can help provide a buffer between pedestrians on the sidewalk and motor vehicle traffic. Looking at neighborhood greenways can provide really great opportunities to improve walkability along some of those local residential streets. But we're also looking at opportunities for placemaking, urban design, where can we improve pedestrian crossings, put in curb extensions, things like that, so we can improve the pedestrian experience as well and make sure that it's an accessible network. We also looked at the impacts on transit operations and bus stop design as a result of the network. And this was a really important consideration as we designed the network. BC Transit, who operates the local transit service in Victoria, has a frequent transit network that's identified. So for the most part, we tried to avoid placing cycling infrastructure on the frequent transit network to try and mitigate impacts on the transit network. In some cases, we did have to provide facilities on a FTN corridor. As one example, Fort Street was one of the cycle tracks, but to mitigate the impacts on that frequent transit corridor, recognizing that transit is very important for how people move about the city, we put the cycle track on the opposite side of the street, on the left side of the street, so there would be no impacts with transit. And then we looked at some bus stop designs and how we could provide dedicated transit landing pads and wrapping the cycle tracks behind those and other tools to mitigate the impacts on transit operations and transit stops. We looked at streets, trees, and landscaping. Again, since we were working within curb to curb width, this wasn't a huge issue, but something we were mindful of throughout the process. And then perhaps the two that are probably the most contentious and challenging in any community are perceptions of the impacts on traffic operations and parking and loading. And so we did multimodal analysis, looked at existing and projected traffic operations at all the corridors and intersections along the city, and also looking at the parking impacts. A number of the corridors that we recommended are on what I would call commercial high streets, business streets through some of the villages throughout the city, and so we wanted to understand parking demand and supply within those areas. And that was certainly a concern that we heard from the public, and so we wanted to look at what mitigation strategies we could use to mitigate those. So as I mentioned, the overall network is about 25 kilometers that we identified for implementation by 2018. But I also mentioned the city's current budget is $7.75 million. And unfortunately, with that current funding allocation, we're not able to build out an entire 25-kilometer network. But we did recommend a phased approach for the city where it would start with a phase one, as you can see in the top left, which would be a downtown network of all ages and abilities facilities, which would be about 5.5 kilometers of cycle tracks within the downtown core, very similar to the extent of the network in the city of Calgary that was the focus of the previous webinar. So similar in scale to provide that downtown network, and that can fit within the city's existing budget. But that's not sufficient. As I mentioned, the city has goals in its strategic plan to create a network that connects to all neighborhoods and destinations throughout the city. So it is still important to not stop there and go beyond this downtown network and reach out to implement through further phases of the network to reach out to all neighborhoods and destinations throughout the city. So, oh happy day, the Biketoria plan was approved. City Council in early May unanimously approved the Biketoria project and approved The implementation of this phase one network, as you can see here, so the implementation of this network by 2018, and also directed staff to identify other funding sources so they could continue to implement the rest of the network by 2018. So there's a commitment within the financial plan currently to build this network. The first corridor, Pandora Avenue, is already or will be under construction soon and will be constructed this fall, and then the rest of the corridors will be built over the next couple of years. And again, the city's now identifying strategies and sources of other funding that might help to build more of the network beyond just this phase one network by 2018. And with this is a quote from Gil Penulosa that just talks about the potential and of what Biketoria can be when it implements this network, and really the opportunity in the title of this presentation about how Biketoria aspires to be one of the world leading cities or small cities for cycling. And by developing a citywide network of all ages and abilities bicycle facilities, it really can be a leader nationally and both internationally. So thank you, and I pass it back to Darren and a panel discussion.
Yeah, I was just going to offer just a few comments back on the the presentation. Thanks for that, Brian. That was really great. So just, you know, a few things that struck me was, and I'll get into this a little bit with the panel discussion, but I kind of really like the quality of the engagement and the fact that the engagement was this kind of process that you went out to where people are rather than expect people to come to you. And it's one of the big flaws we tend to do is that, you know, we'll organise some meeting in some drafty community hall in an open house or public meeting format that, you know, on a cold winter's night, and expect that, you know, people will come out, and the people will come out, all the people who have very strong feelings one way or the other about a particular project. So I really like that that approach. I really like the principles that you went through. I like this idea of the comfortable, the complete, the demand, and the doable. And I thought those were a really good set of, you know, really easy to grasp principles around it. Sense of the, you know, sort of scale of the project in relation to the scale of the city, and the level of, you know, accessibility it will provide to key destinations, and particularly being within 400 metres of schools and parks and all of that. So really, you know, thanks for that. I'm just going to pop out a few questions, and I'll target them at the panelists. I don't know if Ed's on. I'm hoping he is, because he's going to be the recipient of one of the questions. If not, I'll sort of throw it open to others. So, and the first one, really, I want perhaps Jeremy, if you would, you know, kick off on this. And Brian sort of got into this a little bit in the presentation. For a long time, you know, Biketoria done really well with the Lochside and the Galloping Goose trails, and sort of, you know, yeah, I think that had been a contribution to getting quite a, you know, an impressive cycling mode share. But yeah, you know, I've had the impression, I've been in Biketoria sort of last year and the year before, and talking to people there, that, you know, that Biketoria had been kind of resting on its laurels for quite a while. And so Brian kind of alluded to the political support. So I was just wondering, you know, what were the game changers in terms of this catalyst for moving the conversation forward about cycling quite quickly in Biketoria? So I was just wondering if you had any insights on that.
Yeah, for sure. Thanks to Brian for the great presentation. I just think it's time. And we, you know, in our documents, all of our planning documents, it talks about how we're the cycling capital of Canada, and how we have a pyramid of priority in terms of transportation that has pedestrians at the top, cyclists, and then cars. But in reality, we hadn't been implementing our own policies. So it was actually an opportunity. The political work that had been done to get these things in our policies actually opened the door for us to almost call us on our own bluff and get to implementing it. So I think there was a few factors. Brian mentioned the changing demographics. I think that is one. But we have seen support for the Biketoria plan across all ages, and I think that's great as we're trying to build an all ages and abilities network. I think the political change in the election was key, and our strategic planning process, which was very open to the public and allowed for public to weigh in and say what their priorities were. And during that process, We heard from a lot of people who wanted cycling to be a priority of our council. And for me, I ran on a platform of building an all ages and abilities network, and knocked on most doors in the city and talking about that. And I think our mayor Helps did as well. And so having the new political momentum paired with great work by Ed Pullman and other advocates, as well as just general support in the public, really opened the door. And I think the timing is right in terms of a real sense of a new Biketoria coming that is focused on economic growth through social enterprise, the tech sector, and tourism, and the shift in tourism that really is shifting towards people who want to experience what locals are experiencing. And also, when I met with the executive director of Viatech, which is our tech booster locally, I said, what do we need to do as a local government to encourage tech businesses? And he said, we need a livable city. We need a city that's vibrant and fun for people, that, so we can attract employees, that's walkable, cyclable, and livable. And so I think we have a good confluence of factors here that allow us to make this progress quickly. And yes, I think all of those factors combined allowed us to open the door. And you know, at this point, we've only approved funding up to phase one. I'm still, by 2018, I'm still hopeful that we'll get more than that done by 2018.
Yeah, thanks for that. And yeah, so one of the observations I've made in this kind of process is that a lot of cities are working really, really hard on this. And to even keep pace with the average, you know, you've got to be kind of, you know, at that level to be doing that. I mean, I'm going to have a little kind of advertorial for my own city, that in, you know, a city of 1.5 million, and that our program for the next 3 years is $200 million. We're looking at another $200 million for the 2018 to 2021 period. One of our big advantages, we've got central government on board. We've got the Minister of Transport on board, and you know, who's a cyclist himself, and who sees the future as, you know, as being in protected bikeways. So I just wonder if anybody else had any thoughts on the question of what was the catalyst in Biketoria?
I would tend to concur with Jeremy. I think there's been just an absolute sea change in our city and a recognition that we need to compete not just locally with the other municipalities for the people that live here, but also nationally and internationally, both to keep our homegrown talent here in town so that they can sort of underpin really strong businesses and good, you know, authentic economic development, but also so that we can attract good people to our city as well that, again, can create businesses, create jobs, create prosperity. And I think having livable density is a really important part of that, because that's what so many of the, you know, millennials as well as some of the younger Gen Xs are really looking for.
Yeah, and absolutely. I mean, cities are in this great hunt for talent, and often very mobile talent, and you know, often the kind of urban vibe of the city, and particularly how it provides for non-car, you know, travel choices is really important to that. So yeah, fully agree with that. Okay, I was going to kick into a question for Jane now, and this is probably a classic question that comes up in cycling consultations sort of around the place, these sorts of processes. We know that bikes mean business, and there's a strong evidence base that even though a cyclist on an individual trip to a store may spend less than a car driver, that they'll visit more often and in total spend more. But there's often a perceptual barrier in businesses, and that perceptual barrier is that everybody drives, and that the people who drive are the richest people and the people who spend the most. The question is, how do you overcome that perceptual barrier? And the interesting part is, you know, why was Fort Street, why was your particular business area that you're involved in different and supportive of better cycling infrastructure from the get-go?
So I think to answer the second part first, Fort Street is a bit of a unique case. It's a central downtown street. It is a one-way street. It was designed when cars were king, and so it really does feel like a thoroughfare out of town. It's got three wide lanes. It's not very pedestrian-friendly for the vast majority of it, and yet it has all these fantastic small sort of Main Street-style retail bays that are really underutilized right now and are really struggling to keep feet on the street, because good retailers know that what they really need is having feet on the street. So we have a very strong business district in the area, and we've been very involved in a lot of different initiatives, including installing Biketoria's first parklet. We do a whole host of things like block watch activities, so we're very connected. And so I think as a result of that, we've already started having conversations about the need for mid-block crosswalks, other things that could be done to improve the sidewalks, to improve walkability, so that retailers could have more feet on the street. And so I think the real benefit that they saw with bike lanes was there was the ability to improve the walkability as part of that. The other thing with 4th Street is because it is three lanes going one way, there's actually not going to be a very significant loss of parking. They're just going to be removing one of the car lanes and putting in a two-way cycle track. And so I think obviously one of the main concerns for retailers is parking, and the fact that there wasn't a huge loss of parking here makes that a very easy street to work with. But that being said, I do think the basic principles of some of the things that worked really well for 4th Street can hold pretty much anywhere else. I think one of the things that came out of the fact that we do have a really strong business district is that our businesses are treated with a lot of respect. And I think the main thing that people need to realize when they're doing any kind of cycling engagement with businesses is that the businesses that are going to be most heavily affected are not big multinational corporations that can necessarily withstand one or two down months as the track gets implemented. For a lot of them, they're small mom and pop shops at the local retailers that are really important to support, and they don't necessarily have the resources to withstand two, three, even, you know, six bad months, and they'll end up having to close their doors. So I think that's something that is really important with 4th Street as well. Again, the idea of presenting cycling as part of sort of a greater all village planning strategy, I think, is a really important key piece too. And so whenever myself or Terry Houston or a whole host of other people who are involved in the fabulous 4th Street Business Association spoke about cycling, we always talked about it in the context of what it would do to the, you know, to the feet on the street and the overall feel of the area, rather than talking about it just as cyclists. We also make a point of not talking about, I think in general, just not talking about cyclists is an important thing too. If you can talk about people's customers or people on bike or people on feet, that's obviously much better. I think you want to rid people of the concept of the cyclist being the guy in the reflective jacket, because that's not what a lot of the retailers are seeing in their customers. And then I think whatever you can possibly do to gather data, and I think this is what we're hoping to do with 4th Street, or what the city's hoping to do with 4th Street, is actually gather data on the success of the bike lane implementation and then use that data to basically make a case for other areas and to make the economic case. That's actually what's happened in Vancouver. The downtown Vancouver BIA has completely reversed their opinion on bike lanes downtown, partly because of an economic impact study that was done that showed that only 20% of the customers came in cars. So I think anything along those lines that can be demonstrated to the businesses is really beneficial. So if you can orchestrate those small wins, it makes it much easier to roll out bike lanes in other business districts.
Yeah, I'd have to fully agree with all those observations, and the Stantec study of the impact of bike lanes really pulled out that figure, and that in the worst case scenario that the impact was very minor, having that evidence base. And it's, but there's this consistent evidence base around the place that retailers, merchants overestimate their car mode share. I just saw one recently in Agricola Street in Halifax, and that was something like over half of businesses estimated that over three quarters of their customers came by car, and the actual percentage was 16% was the car mode share in that particular area, quite a walkable area in the Halifax Peninsula. Yeah. And I think the other observation is the need to work with business associations and just to partner with them. I think of, you know, like Old Strathcona on 124th Street in Edmonton, as, you know, we're, you know, engaging with the business associations, and, you know, that sort of innovation that comes out from the business association and parklets and advocating for better environments for pedestrians is really important. So that was, you know, some really, really great observations there. I'll kick into the next question. This is a question for Ed, so I'm going to be really interested to see what Ed has to say about this. And so one of my observations about Canada is, that a lot of these decisions are made on the floor of councils, and often by councils elected by wards, and that the words don't always match the rhetoric, and that observation's been made. And I think kind of Edmonton's the poster child for a city that has the Waze documents, has a really, really great policy and strategic framework, but really struggles with implementation and is only really getting underway with protected bikeways. Halifax has done a reimagined transit system, called Moving Forward Together, but it's going to take them 5 years to implement it. That all these things are painfully slow. Edmonton's first protected bike lane implementation will do three blocks this construction season. So that's kind of an observation I've made about Canada is often the painfully slow process. I mean, we're doing 52 kilometres of protected bikeway in 3 years in our city, and the risk of being left behind. So Biketoria is really ambitious by Canadian standards, and the point is that, you know, you're doing the same size network as the Calgary Cycle Track pilot, and you know, City of Victoria is 80,000 in a metro area, 350,000. Calgary's 1.2 million. So on a per scale basis, you're actually kind of, you know, you could be viewed as being more ambitious than that. But the question has to be, one, Calgary, you know, implemented their cycle track pilot, you know, pretty rapidly once it was decided, although there was a lot of planning that sat behind it. And the question is, do you think that Biketoria is ambitious and fast enough? Question for Ed. You'll need to unmute your microphone. We're not hearing you, Ed. So in the audio panel, there's a little microphone icon, and you just need to click on that until it goes green. Well, maybe what you with us, Ed? Okay, it's just what. In the meantime, I just wonder if anybody else had any observations on the ambition and speed.
Yeah, I'll comment on it. Ed said is unmuted, but we still can't hear him. So I'll comment on it. I, you know, when originally pushing for this plan that turned into the Biketoria plan, I really was hoping that we would get into every neighborhood by 2018. So in that way, I'm, you know, although I'm excited about the Biketoria plan, I am a little disappointed that if we only implement phase one by the end of 2018, by 2018, we won't actually reach into every neighborhood in the city, which I think is the stated goal in our strategic plan, is connect every neighborhood and every neighborhood village center with each other and with the downtown core. So in that way, I see it as not quite as ambitious, and the lesson learned for me there is we have to approve the funding ahead of time, as I think at least there was some thought that we would figure out what the network was and then figure out the money, but then they didn't align, and so now we're trying to figure out money with a network that's already designed, and so looking at other sources for that money. I think the way Calgary went ahead with pilot projects, I think, could have worked in Victoria as well, especially if we wanted to see what we could build out more than phase one. I think it is important to get at least some of the infrastructure done in a permanent way, and I think so building out this phase one is a good step, but perhaps interim treatments and pilot projects could have helped us build out faster.
Okay.
Hello.
Do we have an Ed?
Am I there?
Yes, we have an Ed. Ed.
Okay, so great. Mute me. So sorry about that, folks. So yeah, so I did sit on the technical advisory committee for this project and have been following it obviously very carefully as it's gone along. The GVCC was we have about 500 members in the Greater Victoria area, about 2,000 on our mailing list, and we've certainly been very active. In the past couple of years, one in getting the City of Victoria to we were very pleased when the city approached us about 2 years ago now to say that, hey, we want to update the cycling master plan after 20 years and said, let's get on that. And so that's definitely been an ongoing process, and we're really, really happy to see Urban Systems and an external consultant brought on board to essentially help the city in developing this plan, because it's been clear to us that there's been a bit of a deficit at the city and the staff level in terms of the capacity of staff to take on an ambitious project like this. So back to the original question, do I think Biketoria is ambitious and fast enough? The answer is no, I don't think it's ambitious or fast enough. But I'm also not convinced that the City of Victoria has the political will or resources to make it go any faster. So when folks are probably somewhat familiar with Mia Burke, she's a transportation planner consultant and cycling advocate based out of Portland. She was the she's a principal at Alto Planning. So she gave a talk at the Biketoria launch about December last year, and she kind of pointed to the fact that to build good cycling infrastructure and essentially to build better communities, better living spaces, and all of these things, and get us out of our cars and create more livable communities, we really need three elements. We need strong political leaders, capable and willing staff, and champions in the community needed to build better cycling cities. And I certainly think we have elements of these three things, but I don't think they are strong enough to generate the political will and also withstand the inevitable backlash that occurs to build a AAA network in a faster time frame. So just to speak about that more, certainly we have less rested on our laurels here in Biketoria. What was considered a good cycling facility back in the 90s and even in the early 2000s by today's standards has definitely fallen off. Really, the challenge we have is that we haven't quite fully embraced the new paradigm here in Biketoria. The primary concern of traffic engineers is still the impact on traffic speeds. And this was seen very clearly in staff's report on the consultant report of the Biketoria network. So the Biketoria consulting team released their final report, and then they released their final report, and then they that's my cat. Cute. So they released the final report with the four north, south, four east, west routes, and then city staff came back and essentially removed all of the components. City staff deferred all of the technically difficult components. So two in particular. Cook Street north of Pandora, for folks that are familiar. So they recommended Cook Street south of Pandora to Cook Street Village, essentially, but then also recommended, Cook Street north of Pandora said, okay, we're going to move the facility over to Vancouver Street. And I mean, anyone that has, and anyone knows that, and anyone who's versed in this stuff knows that, well, your facility should be continuous. You shouldn't be changing the road halfway through. Ditto on Humboldt, not Humboldt Street, on Government Street between Humboldt and Yates Street, so that that stretch of Government Street where there's no parking, actually. It's actually, they've been talking about doing a pedestrian mall there for decades. And still, we saw concerns from city staff saying, well, don't know about that. So essentially they kicked the can on the very difficult parts and said, we're going to do the easy stuff first, which is fine. I have no problem with them doing the easy stuff first. I mean, as Jane stated, Fort Street and Pandora, you've got the opportunity to take a lane and to just remove some parking to improve sight lines. But no objection to doing the easy stuff first. But certainly it was a bit disappointing to see, it was a bit disappointing to see that the most challenging aspects of the plan, they've essentially said, we're going to do them at a later date. And frankly, I mean, that may not be till 10 or 20 years in the future. So the staff component has improved, and it was good to have the consultants on side to really hopefully, kind of show them what alternatives are out there and, show them best practices. But there's still definitely the need for greater staff capacity and I think a greater willingness to take those risks. So that's the staff side. I mean, the political side, we're fine. We've got a supportive council. We've had a supportive council for a while. There's nobody on council who's outright opposed to improving cycling infrastructure. The staff side, we're okay. On the, as I've just talked about, the community side is challenging as well. And I mean, I'm going to refer a bit back to Jane's points that, you really need champions in the community and you need to identify those people very early on and get them speaking and get them talking in favor, whether those are community leaders or business leaders, but I mean, especially business leaders, they hold a lot of power and, strong opposition from even a few businesses can cause other businesses that may be in favor to be more silent or neutral on the issue and neutral businesses to become more hostile. And, as Jane was just saying, I mean, businesses, these are folks who are mom and pop shops who are running on very minor margins. So any loss of parking and any perceived loss of, a loss of revenue is going to get them out in force opposing it. And for those businesses that think they're going to, that bike lanes are going to be their detriment, they're going to fight a lot harder than the businesses who think bike lanes are good, because, these businesses do okay, and they don't see bike lanes as integral to their success the same way that a business opposed to it sees a bike lane as potentially going to ruin their business. So that's just to say, and you know, this issue comes up with development projects all the time. I mean, you know, those who are opposed to it are much more passionate, much more organized than those that are in favor of them. Not saying anything too controversial there. So a canvas must be done very early on. In my mind, there was definitely a bit of a disconnect between the city staff and the consultants regarding essentially whose job it was to go out and do the consultation fully. And the challenge there is that I think there was a good initial round of consultation set up, but once you get somebody opposed to it who's going around and then talking to businesses and, you know, essentially I would say spreading falsehoods, there really wasn't, in my opinion, enough of a counter effort from city staff and the consultants in terms of pushing back on that. Now, they're in a difficult position there because city staff can't be seen as advocating for it because this hasn't actually been formally approved by council. But at the same time, I mean, you know, you've got a situation out there where you have several leaders of the business community that are traveling around to other areas, not just in their own area, but other areas of the city and saying, and essentially trying to drum up as much opposition as possible to kill this project. And you don't have somebody on the flip, on the positive side of that, doing that, and we really didn't necessarily see that level of leadership from the city in terms of going out and directly kind of confronting that and saying, actually, this is what's going to happen. And to a degree, I mean, that's still, you know, a lot of that is still in terms of the exact designs and what it's going to look like. I mean, we had those initial designs, but in terms of the exact impact, that's really not going to be known until much later in the process when we have, when we're at whatever, 90% detailed design drawings instead of, you know, 50%. So anyways, I think I've said enough there. So.
Yeah, well, those are some great insights. I'll just kick in briefly. I like the point about the three points, the political leadership, the capable staff, and the champions in the community, and they're the three kind of, you know, parts of the tripod. And you need them all there, and I think you think about the Vancouver downtown cycle tracks and done over a number of years, and there was always this kind of idea that you should just have pulled off the Band-Aid in one go and just gone through it. Jane, you were going to say something?
Yeah, I was going to just concur with that. I think, as far as consulting with the businesses, it's probably, in addition to just giving them the respect and understanding that they really are just people, I think the most important thing is to communicate early and often, and not just through forums and panels and events, but really to actually physically go out and walk around and talk to people, because they're often so busy. They're in their stores, 10 hours a day, and they don't have time or interest to necessarily take their time away from their family to go, find out about the bike lanes. So I think whatever you can do to actually go physically there to talk to them. But I think what's really critical is not just talking to them about the what, but also the how. Because one of the things that I dealt with the most with my tenants, and I spent a huge amount of time hand-holding them, particularly the ones on Oak Bay Avenue, which was a very controversial section of the proposed route, it was really about the fact that they thought it was already a done deal. They didn't realize that the consultant's report still had to go through city staff approval and then council approval. And so even just understanding what that process looks like is such a huge part of the communication, and I think it was something that was really badly missed with the business community with the Biketoria project, and I think would have potentially fended off some of the real backlash that happened amongst the business community.
Yeah, and I think there's a part in what Ed had to say about the metrics we have are all about the harmonious flow of the motorized vehicle. And, in the car-oriented post-World War II era, it's all about level of service with these wonderful letter grades. Letter grade A is a letter grade, that is only ever achieved in car commercials. It's never achieved in real life and is economically extremely inefficient, but sounds great. Or we achieve it on the west coast of the South Island, on State Highway 6, where there might be a car every 30 minutes. So that's one thing. We don't have good metrics around walking and cycling. We don't measure them as well as we measure cars. We don't, and it comes down to a little bit of that. We measure, what matters to us, and walking and cycling should really matter more to us than it does. So I think there's an element of that, and just a sort of a kind of default perception towards the movement of vehicles as the top priority of the transportation system. And I think, we're still moving away from that. There's another part of it which is around staff capability. And, I have this, we've got an extreme shortage of talent in walking and cycling in New Zealand. I'm possibly the same in Canada, you know, that the really good people in cycling, the Brian Pattersons and the Ryan Martinsons, the Tyler Gollies, those sorts of people really need to be cloned several times over. You know, so that really should be a significant science investigation in Canada about how to, you know, clone the key talent in that area, because I think there is there's a lack of capacity, and there's often a politically risk-averse culture that you know, councillors will get called in the middle of the night by enraged residents about, you know, whatever it is that issue, you know, they're thinking about the next municipal election whenever that comes up. So I think there's a bunch of stuff about that. I've just got just got one final question, and it's kind of a little bit kind of around the edge of this, but Brian alluded to it, is that Victoria's made up of 13 municipalities, and there's an electoral area in First Nations, and then there's capital regional district that does coordination. And, you know, at some stage you're actually going to hit the city boundary. You're going to get into a SkyMelt or Saanich or Oak Bay, and, you know, how do you kind of, you know, make that next step? Do you role model something really great in the city of Victoria that the surrounding municipalities want, or do you work with them now to come up with a more coordinated, longer term plan about how you cross the boundary at that point?
So. Yeah, good question. So one thing I didn't mention, I mentioned the city's bicycle master plan, but the Capital Regional District, which kind of oversees the 13 municipalities and First Nations, developed a regional pedestrian and cycling master plan a few years ago. And so that lays out kind of a vision and framework for the regional cycling network and provided an important foundation for what we were looking at here. And it also sets mode share targets, and pretty significant mode share targets for cycling within the CRD. So I think that's an important piece of the puzzle, that there's that benchmark in place and regional support for cycling as well, but the actual implementation of that network comes down to each of these 13 different jurisdictions, municipalities, plus First Nations. And something we were looking at through this study, I mean, one of our principles was really to focus on the core, the hub of the city's network, which is also the hub of the regional network, but we also want to identify corridors that connected with surrounding municipalities. So it's something we're mindful of, and I think a number of the other municipalities are also doing good work for cycling. Saanich is a suburban municipality just to the north of Victoria. It's actually larger than Victoria. It's got over 100,000 residents, and I think they're looking at developing a plan this year as well. So I do think what the city's doing can help to be a catalyst for other municipalities in the region and lead to them taking hopefully similar initiatives. And I would say we've seen that in the city of Vancouver and Metro Vancouver region, where the city here in Vancouver has done fantastic work over the past 6 or 7 years developing a network of all ages and abilities facilities in kind of the metro core, we call it. But since that has been happening, we've seen other suburban municipalities around the region really embracing that, and we're seeing City of North Vancouver, example, has a all ages and abilities bicycle network plan. City of Surrey is really focusing on implementing a cycle track network in their downtown as well, their emerging downtown. So I think a lot of cities, they've seen the success of Vancouver firsthand, and they're able to now build on that, and their councillors are seeing that, the businesses are seeing that, and you can start to kind of see that momentum carrying forward into other municipalities in this region.
Yeah, I'd have to agree with that. And of course, you know, we're doing something similar, but we were inspired by the Vancouver Downtown Cycle Track Network and, you know, the impacts that's had. And we're partway through our implementation. We've almost got the outer ring of the minimum grid in the city centre complete. And we've had a 26% increase in cycling in the last year on the basis of that. But the interesting thing is that the feeders that already existed, the Northwestern Cycleway, the major cycleways that we had, have had an even bigger increase. They've had a 35% increase. And these were fully protected facilities that were already in place, but they just dumped you, much like the Galloping Goose dumps you on the, you know, by the bridge on Johnson Street. But by connecting that up to something in the core, it actually gave us big, you know, big gains in the core and big gains on the feeders. So it'll be interesting to see what happens on the Galloping Goose and the Lockside as a result of that, because I suspect you'll get a big bump on those as well. Because the effects are not just on the network itself, but in anything that connects to it. So that's been does anyone else have any observations about the, you know, the interesting governance, you know, richness of governance that you have in Greater Victoria? Highlands and Oak Bay and other rather smallish places by international standards.
Well, it makes, I mean, you've got such different, you've got wildly different design standards and funding and everything. So View Royal, for instance, which is one of the Western communities, has been doing great stuff around cycling infrastructure. Well, not AAA, but I mean, for the past 10 years, they've been pretty consistently building bike lanes versus, say, Oak Bay, which has one 12-hour bike lane in all of its municipality. So versus Saanich, who's really been doing some great stuff over the past few years. So it's a real mishmash here, and it's a bit frustrating because, I mean, we've seen, so for instance, we had the adoption of the pedestrian cycling master plan almost about 5 years ago now, and really I don't think that anything really came from that plan, frankly. It was just, it was a bold, ambitious vision, calling for 25% trips by bike in urban areas by 2036 and 15% in rural areas by 2036. But I mean, when you think about it, like 25% is huge, 15% in rural areas is huge. And really, if we're going to achieve that goal by 2036, we're nowhere near where we need to be to make that happen, I think. So there's ongoing disconnects between the regional government and the municipal government, especially on transportation issues. And that's not even discussing transit, which is a whole other can of worms. We've had BC Transit that's been actively opposing installation of bike lanes because of their belief that this is going to undermine transit travel times. So really, we've got a big mess of a governance here in Greater Victoria, and it definitely is a detriment, and is not really working in our favour, I would say.
Yeah, I'd have to agree with that, and my rebuke to BC Transit would be deal with the dog's breakfast of the network that you have and decide what your frequent transit grid is and all of those things. So, that's my own personal view from having experienced almost done my head in to try and work out how to get around on transit in Victoria. So there was a question that came in the chat window. I think we'll probably run through the Q&A bit, and it's quite an interesting question from Dean, and it says, can an AAA route network increase promote development the same way transit can? And it's is there data to support that? And it's this idea of trail-oriented development, and probably I think Minneapolis is a place that's probably in that area. So I was just wondering if anybody, maybe Brian or someone, has any kind of observations about that, the impact of a bike network on the sort of, development we want, walkable, cyclable communities that are around,
Well, it's pretty much an ironclad law of real estate that the piece of land is going to be more valuable if people can get to it more easily. So there's quite a bit of evidence across the United States showing that putting in any kind of active transportation, type facilities in an area is really directly correlated with an increase in property value and an increase in development. I think also for developers, the fact that bike lanes often go alongside with reduced parking requirements is a huge factor, because so many projects don't get off the ground because the cost of the parking stalls are just so hugely expensive to build. They add so much, from the time frame point of view to a project, because you have to dig such a deep hole. And then also just cost-wise, they're extremely expensive to produce. And so they, increase basically the cost of whatever it is that you're trying to sell, whether it be condo or retail or office space, which in turn affects the project's feasibility. So there's so many reasons, I think, for developers to get behind bike lanes. And we're already seeing that in Victoria. One of the newest, more interesting residential developments downtown called Black and White is actually featuring tons of bikes, and their advertising abstract is written in support of the bike lanes going in along Fort Street. And they've also are providing electric bikes in their strata building as part of one of the amenities that it's being offered, so that people can take advantage of the bike lanes that are going to be going in. So they're really betting on the fact that bike lanes are going to be a big part of downtown, more urban living.
And I think on building it, we see parking variance asks with most development proposals now. And so And as part of knowing that we're trying to shift the mode share away from people driving cars to active modes of transportation, we are reviewing our parking requirements right now, specifically for the downtown core. And I think, building this network is a key part of that.
Yeah, and I think the parking's a really important issue. I mean, Calgary got around that issue by being able to do more replacement parking stalls than what they took away to take some of the heat away. But often, you know, they must have had the luxury of space or the ability to be able to do that. And a lot of cities simply don't have that. I'd have to say experience in my own city that having parking maximums downtown and extremely expensive land, which encourages developers to provide only the absolute minimum that they think they can get away with, is really important. So I'd urge that approach for Victoria. That, and often the standards, they're based on trip generation rates in very suburban contexts where there are no good transit and bike and walk options, and so they generally tend to significantly overestimate the requirement for parking, and particularly in urban core and downtown areas. Then what happens is if you overprovide, you tend to create the demand to use those spaces. So I wish you luck in that journey, but it's certainly a journey that I think you should be undertaking. Does anyone else in the participants, feel free to pop in something into the chat window, or just talk, turn on your microphone and talk.
I just dropped a PDF with some from ULI with some information about active transit and real estate development that was really good. It just came out a couple months ago.
Awesome.
I have to log off. I've got a meeting starting right now. So I wanted to say thanks to the organizers and thanks to everyone who participated. And if you have any questions for me, feel free to email me at jloveday@victoria.ca. I'd be happy to answer that way. And it's been fun. And thanks so much for having me on and for your interest in cycling in Victoria.
Great. Well, thanks, Jeremy. It's been great having you. Yeah, I see Ed was making a comment about the need to avoid the spillover parking issue, which is one of the fears that comes from these things, that if you take parking out somewhere, it kind of spills over somewhere. And people who can often be quite territorial about the parking outside their home or that they use, it is actually part of the public realm, not the private realm, but people do take quite a bit of ownership of that. And I've sort of noted the controversy and Point Grey Road in Vancouver, of residents upset about the resumption of some of the public realm to provide decent walking facilities in that area and land that is in fact in the public realm. So probably needs to emphasise the point that if it's in the public realm, it is in the public realm. It's not part of your private space. So anyone else out there got some questions or insights or something to share? I'm listening and waiting. There's been quite an interesting chat. Oh, okay. So waiting for name is asking, Brian, can you tell us a bit more about the demand analysis downtown? So question for Brian.
Sure, yeah. So we did a few technical GIS-based analyses that I didn't get into too much in the presentation here. When we looked at demand, this was less so of an analysis. We were just looking on a neighborhood basis and a census tract basis, where is the highest mode share currently within the city? But we also looked at cycling potential, we called it. So we know where people are already cycling based on that mode share data, but we want to know where is the greatest potential to increase that, which also pointed to downtown. And that analysis is looking at absence of cycling infrastructure, but looking at land use, residential density, employment density, land use mix, topography, street network characteristics, things like that, the foundational building blocks of a neighborhood, and did an analysis of those factors and put that together to figure, based on community characteristics like land use, transportation conditions, and topography, where would the greatest potential be for you to invest? And that pointed to the same neighborhoods, just downtown, with the highest potential. We also did another analysis that was looking at equity. So in this case, we were looking at where are the highest proportions of children and seniors and low-income people throughout the city. So we kind of put all these analyses together, all of which kind of helped to to make a case for why we should really start with downtown. It's where the highest number of people are already cycling. It's the highest employment base. We think there's a lot of potential there. From an equity perspective, it makes sense. So we really wanted to start there and then use that analysis to provide that justification and then build a network out from that.
Okay, well, that's a good answer to the question. There's another question that's popped in, or a couple of questions from Dean. And the first one is, how do you get through to engineering departments? And follow-up comment of, we have an engineering department that is very risk-averse. They design everything. Councillors generally pro-safe infrastructure, but never acts without the recommendation of administration. Any tips to reconcile this political football? And it's the kind of, you know, how it's sort of about the engineering culture, which is often, you know, very empathetic to the needs of drivers and what I describe as kind of viewing life through the windscreen of a car. So any observations there, maybe Brian or someone else?
I think in the case of Biketoria, one example here is that the Pandora Avenue cycle track, which was started before the Biketoria project as kind of a standalone, and it's the first corridor that will be implemented. And I think council was quite involved in Biketoria with the design of Pandora Avenue because it's the first one, and there is no example of this in Biketoria. And I think a lot of communities, if they don't have a good example and they haven't actually seen it firsthand, they probably do have a higher desire to be involved and maybe through the design process. But hopefully, you know, in this case here in Biketoria, what, now that Pandora has been done, a lot of lessons have been learned, and you can build on that, that council maybe will see less need to be involved in the details, and I think that can help with other cities as well once they've kind of been through it and see how it can work. That can, that alone can help answer some questions.
So yeah, I can I should speak to the Pandora experience, because it's actually a good case discussion here, because actually when so back in around September 2014 when they were redrafting the bicycle master plan, they came forward and said, okay, well, here's our plan. And they outlined a series of routes. One of them was Pandora. And then they said, we want to build Pandora first. So, you know, we're going to ask council to please let us, authorize us to go off and do design drawings for Pandora Street. And the Cycling Coalition, right away, we said you should be considering a two-way on Pandora instead of just a one-way, because we saw various benefits having a two-way on Pandora. So our intervention there, that motion was then amended to look at both a two-way and a one-way. And so when that came back to council in early 2015, they had three options for Pandora. One was a two-way. One was a one-way with protected intersections, and the third was a one-way with no protected intersections. So protected intersections being essentially signalized crossing, so essentially having your own dedicated signal. Eliminating right-hand turns on red is the big characteristic there. So plus installing a new signalized timer for traffic making a right-hand turn. So in the staff report, the staff explicitly said, we want to pursue option three because we don't want to deal with the chaos that's going to ensue if we have to retime the traffic network. So their reasoning was, we don't want to consider, which we had a huge issue with, of course, because, you know, hey, you guys said you were going to build AAA facilities. Well, not eliminating these right-hand turns is not a AAA facility, frankly. Expecting folks to mingle with traffic at intersections, that's not a safe facility. So we mobilized our membership and the broader public to write into council to say, take option three off the table, and we're successful. Option three was taken off the table, and then council and then staff went back and re-examined and said, actually, the 2 a.m. Pandora makes a lot of sense. Because if we do a two-way on Pandora, we don't have to do a protected bike lane on Johnson. Johnson is the street just south of Pandora where they're also planning on doing a protected bike lane, but then realized that a protected bike lane on Johnson would eliminate a lot of parking. So they came back and said, well, we'll do a two-way on Pandora and we'll just do a regular painted bike lane on Johnson. And so that was a pretty major victory for us. And really, it was through ongoing political pressure through council. But it's difficult. You don't necessarily, you really need those particular, you need that time in that moment where you need to get that right intervention. And ultimately, it's a result of staff reports. And you need to be on top of those staff reports, reading them in detail. And if you don't like it, submitting, you know, reasonable alternatives and saying you should do this instead, and mobilizing as many folks as possible to come out and support that as possible. So that was certainly one major win for us. Yeah, I mean, obviously getting in, it's real challenging with folks, you know, especially folks who've been doing this job for 20 years and they have, you know, some young Yahoo like me coming up and telling them how to do their job, which they don't really appreciate. So it's a tough one. I mean, new staff, when you hire new staff are certainly a need, definitely. But anyways, that's enough.
Yeah, and there's a couple of observations there as to how important it is to design around intersections and conflict points, dooring zones, and vehicle crossings, and the North American curse, with the exception of the island of Montreal and New York City, of allowing right turn on red, which we're fortunately not here. Our experience is, you know, we cycle separate everything in traffic signal phases to avoid conflicting moves, and that helps. And certainly for cycling, we do that. Traffic signals are timed around the progression of motorized vehicles, and the problem with that is that it's not the same progression speed as cycling. And if you think about the Copenhagen or the best approaches, is that they're basically timing signals for bike progression, you know, which is actually a safer vehicle speed progression. So, and I found that cycling in the protected bikeway network in Vancouver in 2014. It was a great network, but I pretty much hit every single red going through there. Any other observations on that? No. Okay. So there was a comment by Jean about was fortunate to be a planner in charge of engineering and public works, so I was able to provide educational seminars and amazed at our success with public engagement. And we got into real trouble in New Zealand with Wellington, with the first protected bikeway, the island-based cycleway, because people simply couldn't visualise what it was. And this was this whole newfangled thing which some crazy, progressive engineers at the city had dreamed up, and it was a complete paradigm shift for them. And being able to visualize what it is really important. So I'd have to make that observation. And there's a question from Robert: any recommendation for municipalities which are vehemently against bicycle signals and bicycle detection? And also, are bicycle signals being incorporated into the Biketoria plan at any locations other than contraflow facilities? That sounds like a question for Brian.
Yeah, so they are. A lot of those details will be developed in the next phase of design as the city moves into detailed design of the corridors, but especially in areas where we've got high volumes of right-turning vehicles or left-turning vehicles. I think those are some thresholds, and we were looking to some of our team members from Copenhagen to look at kind of how Copenhagen designs that and what sort of thresholds might be required. Adding more bicycle signals, if we could do it everywhere, it would be great. It comes at a significant cost as well. So we're trying to, there's often that discussion as well, is it better to put in the highest quality in bicycle signals everywhere or do different measures or more pilot measures at some locations to try and get more done. So that was a lot of the discussion that we had about bicycle signals and whether they should be at all locations or how we would prioritize those.
Yeah, and again, getting the timing of the bike signals as well. I mean, with some of our cycling facilities in Auckland, we have bike signals, but I'll call up the pedestrian phase because that'll give you longer time to get across. Yes, obviously need to become fitter in my biking and faster in getting across the intersections. Another question from Dean, which is, does Biketoria account for larger bikes like cargo bikes as well?
I can take that one. So we were looking at kind of what's the minimum width for various facilities. So we've got the two-way cycle tracks, which our minimum design would be 3 meters and wider if possible for two-way cycling. And on some of the one-way facilities, we were really trying to maximize the space available for cyclists. So the goal was to have one-way cycle tracks that were at least 2 meters wide or preferably 2.2 or more, which is kind of getting to how wide they are in Copenhagen. So that can allow for cargo bikes and that type of vehicle, but also for side-by-side cycling and just making a more comfortable cycling experience so you're not riding single file in a constrained environment.
Okay. Yeah, and that's come. It often comes down, I think, in our experience, is that you know, if you're taking a single lane, that lane is 3 meters or a little bit over 3 meters, which leaves you with the 1.5 meters if it's you know, bi-directional. And it just comes down to a little bit of a practicality of not having to move curb lines and stuff like that. And oh, yes, the eternal question, and of yeah, which is about the. How do you feel the BC helmet law hampers mode share growth in Victoria?
Darren, unfortunately, I have to step out to another meeting, but thank you guys. This has been lots of fun and really interesting.
Okay, well, it's really great to have you there and really great to have a perspective from business as well, because that's a really important perspective in the process. So thanks, Jane.
No problem. Thank you guys so much. Enjoy your afternoon.
Great, thanks. Okay, we'll get into the helmet law. I can certainly comment from New Zealand, but from BC's point of view, Brian?
Yeah, this is I think the argument is that it has, any jurisdiction that has a helmet law has not seen the level of growth in bicycle use. So I think it does, and especially when we're looking at the non-commute mode share in Victoria, you know, 11% commute mode share, but when we look at the regional household survey data, it shows that it's 4% of all types of trips are being made by cycling, so which is probably more of a realistic number. And yeah, I think the experience in BC and other jurisdictions with helmet laws has shown that it certainly will hamper mode share growth.
Yeah, and absolutely our experience in New Zealand with mandatory cycle laws across the entire country. There was a thing published in the New Zealand Medical Journal about it. You know, there's been some dispute about the numbers, but adult cycling dropped by about 51% and child cycling dropped by a stunning 75%. And so we went to a situation in New Zealand where the school bike sheds went from being full to being empty. And we're really struggling to get back to where we were before the bike helmet law. So that's a kind of an observation from my fear nation state. There's a bunch of other questions popping in about electric bikes. There was a question about electric bikes, and there was a follow-on from the cargo bike question. And you know, that's in cities with steep topography like Auckland, that's an issue, is you know, really powerful electric bikes. I think there's a certain standard that they're allowed in bike lanes. Is there a particular situation in British Columbia, Brian?
I think it would be up to each municipality about use of electric bikes. I think as long as it has a pedal in many jurisdictions, then it would be able to use bike lanes. In the case of Victoria, we didn't specifically look at electric bikes. They would be able to use the network. But it wasn't really a focus, given that it is relatively flat and the distances, especially within the city that we're talking about, are relatively short. And so it wasn't a big factor. But if we're looking at the regional network, that might be more of a consideration. And also here in Vancouver, I think, where it's hillier, that would be a bigger consideration.
Yeah, and certainly, you know, some of our cycleways are just, you know, up to 12% grades, and yeah, they're beyond what my sorry behind can do. So we've got, you know, topography's not on our side. Okay, there's a question about, this was two questions. We'll do the first one, Brian. How did the 2015 Biketoria Network outreach differ from the 2013-2014 consultation when the city completed its master plan? And effectively, I think Biketoria kind of effectively reviewed that master plan.
That's right. So in 2014, the city did a bicycle network plan, which involved consultation. I wasn't involved in that engagement, so I can't really speak to what was done. But I can say that through our process, our initial task was to review the findings of everything that had been done through that 2014 engagement and to review the recommended long-term network that came out of that engagement. So that was kind of our starting point. What did the city hear through that process? What were the recommendations? And then we looked at reviewing and enhancing that network. And I can speak to some of the changes that came out of the network, and one would be the recommended priority network that was identified in 2014 was a little bit different, or quite different from what we identified, and I think that is a reflection of the fact that in 2014, when that was developed, that was under the previous council, and there wasn't a significant funding commitment that we have now. So a lot of the network, priority network that had been identified through the 2014 plan was a lot of low-hanging fruit and maybe not the most more difficult and costly projects. So there was a lot of kind of easier recommendations that were identified in 2014, and we identified some different ones. One example, again, is, as you mentioned, Ed, was Cook Street versus Vancouver Street, picking kind of a commercial arterial street with businesses on it and a really important desire line versus a quieter residential street, which might in some respects be easier to implement, but doesn't provide access, the same level of access to destinations as Cook Street does.
Okay, and there was another question from Robert. It was about what will Biketoria be using as facility design manual. Bike lanes in Ontario typically range from 1.2 to 1.8, but you mentioned 2 and 2.2 meters.
Mm-hmm. I'd say those are our desired widths. We're using NACTO. Ontario has a manual now, OTM Book 18. We've been looking at guidelines from the Crow manual and guidelines in Denmark as well, and having members of our team. So that's kind of the aspiration, is to try where possible to provide 2 to 2.2 meter one-way cycle tracks and minimum 3 meter cycle tracks, ideally 4 meter cycle tracks if we can on two-way streets. But that's an ideal situation. Of course, we're working in the doable guiding principle to fit what we can within curb to curb width. So, I mean, there's going to be pinch points in some locations where we can't achieve that, but that's kind of the aspiration, is to provide enough width that it's comfortable for a parent and their child to ride side by side, or to allow for what they call in Copenhagen to be conversational cycling. So you're not riding single file. So that's the aspiration. But of course, we have to work with the physical realities that we're working within as well.
Okay, well, that was great. That's it for everyone. Just wondered if, you know, Brian or Ed, do you have any final comments or, you know, observations to make?
Well, I think I wanted to say that this is the start of the story. So in contrast to what Ryan was presenting a couple of weeks ago with Calgary's story, you know, they've implemented their downtown cycle track network. So now I think it'll be very interesting to follow this for everybody watching this webinar and us as well over the next 2 years, to see how the city moves forward with implementing these facilities, the pace, and how it can find funding to achieve the rest of the network and go beyond this phase one hub. I think agree with Ed and Jeremy, they mentioned this earlier, that it's probably not ambitious enough, and I would agree with that as well. More certainly needs to be done. This is not a citywide network, it's a downtown network that's currently committed to, which is great, but a lot more needs to be done, so it'll be very interesting to watch it unfold.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to it, and we're watching with interest from the South Pacific. So thanks to Brian and to Ed and to Jeremy and Jane for being part of such a great discussion. Thanks to all of you for participating in this. Of course, if you're interested.
The last thing I would just add quickly is, if anyone wants to, anyone's welcome to reach out to me. Just check out the Greater Victoria Cycling Coalition's website and send us an email. Send us a message on Facebook or look me up, Edward Pullman. And very happy to continue the conversation, especially around what's happening in other cities. Very happy to discuss what's happening here. And I think, everyone benefits from us chatting more. So,
yeah. Well, it's been really great conversation. So, yeah, so thanks to everyone. And a good morning from New Zealand, and a good afternoon to Canada. Thursday's looking good so far. So when you get to Thursday in Canada... So thanks for a great webinar, and for anyone who's interested, the Next Generation Transportation Certificate program kicks off in September, and all the information is available online for that. So thank you very much, and hope to see you in another of these webinar series. Great.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye-bye. Thank you.